Just curious about your initial story. Do you think it was a benefit or a hindrance having it at the end of a series as opposed to starting a new series with it?
You're talking about my first story, Twin Dilemma, being at the end of Peter's series.
Would you rather it have been at the start of them?
Yeah, I think I probably would in retrospect. I think what John Nathan Turner, the producer, did was very brave, which was to introduce... Is it you? To introduce a new doctor who had quite the emotional problems that the sixth doctor had, and then leave it as it did for 9 months in England from the end of Twin Dilemma, and that, well, the glimmer of a softer doctor when I said, I am the doctor, whether you like it or not, and then smiled. And then the audience in Britain had to wait best part of 9 months to find out whether this maniac was the doctor. And I think my time as a doctor always suffered slightly from that. I liked the bravery of making the doctor violent, unpredictable, manic, and all those things in that first story. And I liked the idea of a story arc for my doctor. Because the plan was, I remember saying, one of my favourite books was Pride and Prejudice, because the main character, Darcy, in Pride and Prejudice, is one that you hate for 9/10 of the book. Everyone imitates him, and you, the reader, hate him, because he's arrogant, because he does stuff to ruin people's lives. But right at the end, you discover he's actually the only decent person in the whole thing. That everything he's done has been completely selfless and for other people. And he didn't care what they thought of him, but he wanted to help others. And that is the kind of character I wanted to play. Someone that you could look at and think, I don't think I like him. But he's not bothered about whether you like him or not. He's bothered about doing the right thing, about justice, about improving wherever he is, making it better. And that's what I wanted to play. Starting off with someone that you're going to go, that's not the Doctor, where's that nice Peter Davison gone? That nice, quiet, gentle person who got this nasty, loud, arrogant idiot in appalling clothes, ranting and raving. And then you've got to wait to find out more. So, maybe it was a mistake, I don't know. It wasn't my mistake. If it was a mistake, it was somebody else's.
I was just wondering, how did you actually feel when you actually auditioned and were accepted as the part of the Doctor to be part of the big series?
Well, it seems a little vain to say this, but I didn't audition. I didn't have... It's the only part I've ever had in my career, well, there was one other, where I didn't have to audition, they offered it to me. Which is extraordinary, because it's the biggest part. I played Max Sirron in the Ark of Infinity story, Peter Davison's story, and as a result of that, I met John Nathan Turner, the producer, and we got on very well, we liked each other. I made him laugh, he made me laugh, and we met socially at a couple of events. And he just rang me up out of the blue and said, come in and see me. And said, I'm thinking of offering you the part of the Doctor, because Peter's leaving. Wow. So it's not an offer yet, but I want you to take these tapes, he gave me tapes of all the previous Doctors. Go away, watch them, come back and tell me what you think your Doctor would be like. And I did that. And he said, right, and he took me upstairs to meet the head of serials, the BBC, who was watching cricket on the television. And we talked about cricket, because I love cricket too. We talked about cricket for 20 minutes, and he turned out to John and said, yes, he'll do. And that was it. I had the part, and then I wasn't allowed to tell anybody. I couldn't even tell my own agent. So for several weeks, my agent was ringing up, offering me interviews. I said, no. you know, and then I was able to tell him. Because there's a kind of tradition in Britain that the media go mad when a Doctor Who leaves and another one starts, and they wanted to control when that happened. And suddenly, there I was playing the Doctor. And my other memory is the night I'd finished my first day in the studio playing the Doctor. And I went home, and my wife was sitting reading a book in the corner of our sitting room, and I came in and I stood in the doorway like that, and I said, I am the Doctor. And there was a tiny pause, and she looked up and said, that's lovely, dear. Could you put the rubbish out? Which is, for me, that's the perfect wife. Not impressed.
What was the other part you didn't have to audition for?
The other part I didn't have to audition for was Paul Merrily in The Brothers, which I did for 3 years. The two biggest parts I've had. I came in playing a small part, and they wrote it up. Because I, in that role, in 1975, I was voted by a national newspaper the most hated man in Britain. So I've been the most hated and the most loved. It's quite nice, really. I was a kind of JR from Dallas character.
Hi there.
Hello.
I was wondering if you, since you've been on Doctor Who, have you been watching the series and keeping...
Oh yeah, I've been watching the new stuff.
And what do you think of it?
I love it. Now you see, I'm always amazed when people come up to me. I mean, there'll be people here today who will say to me, I much prefer the classic series to the new series. I don't get that, because for me the new series is fantastic. There's so much they can do with special effects now. It's wonderful. When I think of the hours we used to spend, if a Dalek had to chase from that wall to that wall, it would take 2 hours, because the wretched thing would keep falling over, and it is, he'd bang himself inside as he tripped over something. Now, somebody on the computer does that in 5 seconds. I run on my own, they put the Dalek in afterwards. That didn't happen in my time. Everything we saw actually had to happen in real time. And for me, the scripts are ever so much better now. I think there's some wonderful stuff happening. And I like, some people go on about the tiny, whiny-ness of the new Doctor Who, all that kind of paradox of what the hell is going on. I like that. Life is like that. You walk through other people's lives and you hear snippets of conversation and you think, what's going on there? Because it doesn't make any kind of sense what you've heard. And that is what life is like. And I don't think everything has to be spelled out. I love the fact that you'll watch a story now in Doctor Who and still be thinking about it 6 months later when you see it again. That's why I like things like Twin Peaks and all those things, because they're weird. And the new series for me has had the best line ever from any episode of Doctor Who. The two-parter called The Empty Child and the Doctor Dances, I thought were a brilliant story. You know, the one with the gas masks. And right at the end, Christopher Eccleston said, everybody lives.
Yeah.
And if Doctor Who is about anything, it's about the Doctor celebrating the fact that everybody lives. That's what's important. And all of the new Doctors, I loved Christopher Eccleston. I loved David Tennant. I really, really loved Matt Smith, because he was so kind of random and strange and old and young and lovable and fierce. And he was just so natural for me. And I think Peter Capaldi's going to be stunning, because he's such a good actor. It's exciting times. Exciting times.